Yeah, today our topic is basically we have covered in the almost in the middle of the portion. We have covered the regular language, BFA, finite state machine, and all these. We are also introduced to push-down automata. There also FSM is very important because FSM again the core of PDA, only at a tail like very powerful stack, infinite stack that gives a very powerful. And another is anyone can yes. Then whenever you go to the Turing machine, interestingly, there is no stack, but that is more powerful than PDA. Why? Because the Turing machine had two head, read head and write head, and instead of your finite state machine only read head, it can go only left to right one step at a time. Your PDA finite state machine also try its reading head. It go to left to right only one step at a time. It cannot go back. Back and forth is not allowed in the finite state machine and push-down automata. But whenever you go to the next machine, that is called Turing machine, the Turing machine mainly of two type. One is bounded Turing machine. There is a wall in the left side and right hand side of the wall. That is called linear bounded automata. That is nothing but is Turing machine with a boundation. With the boundary, left and right, it cannot go deep much beyond and right and much beyond the left. That's called linear bounded automata. That is not mighty much research. I tell you why the linear bounded automata is not that interesting. More interesting is no boundary. That it is open up, it gives solution to lots of problems. So same hardware with no boundary. That is called Turing machine. And whenever Turing machine bounded by left hand and right hand, and that is linear bounded automata is required to understand a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n. I have told you this a to the power n, b to the power n is push-down automata. It is a context-free grammar. But whenever you want to generate a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, then your production rule left hand side cannot be context-free. It must have some context so that it can be a variable with some another variable with some another terminal. So that's the rule, and that's rule you have to see it. So that is there are some rules. There are 10 rules are there, so that you can generate a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, and then that is a linear bounded automata Turing machine can solve. And then any formula you put it, any formula that I have, my favorite formula is b square minus 4ac root over divided by 2a minus all this square root. That this formula, if you put anything into formula, anything in formula, then it can be done by Turing machine. That machine with a no bounded right hand side and left hand side. So this is very interesting topic. Turing machine, one of the most powerful machine. In fact, all our laptops are less powerful than Turing machine, though it's simple. So there's lots of plethora of topics you can take for presentation. You can ask me, and you can give your ideas, and that's great. Now, what is the pigeonhole principle? I think your discrete path also, you have already covered this. I already have covered in earlier. This is so interesting, so obvious thing, but it will be applied here and again in automata in various cases. One example of automata I am telling you. Say you have a finite state machine. How can you generate infinite language? So interesting. So if in a combinatorial circuit, like I have yesterday, I have given example. Yes, no, very good, okay. Only five strings are there. The language. Language is a finite language. Only four sentences there. Yes, no, very good, and okay. There's a finite language, no interesting. But if you have it like our English language, or the English is too powerful, even if it's a very other language, English, take the English, the simplest language, in fact, the grammar-wise. So that is the reason I have told you it is most of the programming language are based on English language, not based on Tamil or Bengali, because not it is also another true that fact that we don't have that computer science knowledge in Tamilian or maybe Bengali and other, but in other languages like French, they are definitely smarter people, like Spanish smarter people, Russian they're smarter people. Why the computer languages are not made on this language? Because these languages generically not that context-free language. English is the best one of these. So that is the reason you see the Python, Java, all, even the, you see English is not the highest spoken language, it is Spanish. then comes maybe Chinese, maybe Hindi, but English is a preferred choice in the design, in the programming language. Even the communication all over the world, the Spanish is the number one, I believe. So English has a some inherent grammar. That is, the grammar is very simple grammar, so that you can make your meaningful sentence, many infinite sentences with very few rules, like noun clause and verb clause, and like this. Okay, so what is pre-general principle? That is great. And whenever you see a finite machine can generate infinite language, then there must be some, in like one pigeonhole, there must be some looping activity, maybe one or maybe some within some states, definitely some looping activity. Like, take the example of a to the power m, b to the power n. M and n are different. So, or a to the power m, b to the power, a to the power m, b to the power n, and c to the power q. So, they are all different. M and q are different. So, I think you now understand, or you believe me, that this is a regular language. Why? So, whenever there is a finite state machine, somewhere it is looping through m, somewhere it is looping through a to the power n, somewhere it is looping through b to the power n, and c to the power q. These looping activities done by this pigeonhole principle. There must be some looping activities, otherwise you cannot produce the infinite language. So there must, that is the pigeonhole principle, is the looping activities, and looping activities counters, they should not match with each other. That is the great thing of regular language. So that is the simplicity of the regular language. But whenever you want to measure a to the power n and b to the power n should be equal, then you need a like a stack with a machine, so that whenever a's are coming, you put a's into this. Whenever b is coming, you pop one a and take it out. So ultimately, whenever you end at the string, your stack should be empty. So again, this is, but this is a class. I introduce another technique for regular language. I'll come to the next slide. So pigeonhole principles, I think it tells you that there must be some loops. There must be some place where it loops. I'll come to this. Let's see the next. The pigeonhole, this is the pigeonhole. Say if we have 367 students in our, in your class, there must be, even in the leap year, in say one year a leap year, the 367 students, there must be single date, must be at least one date, at least one date, maybe more date, with two more birthdays. Okay, that is the great thing. So that is the pigeonhole principle says. Okay. So more or less we have little bit covered. Again, your finite automata is very important. Regular language, regular expressions are the same. Another thing is regular set, that is also same. Khali expressions are different. Regular set, we use the union operation by union, and regular expression we use the plus. Plus means union operation. And yesterday's class, I sometimes mentioned the language R dot S. You can, better it is R dot S or sometimes R S. That is, means R. First R string, then A string, or for R, that is a concatenation. R plus S means either R or S. Okay, so that is a, but both are regular. Two regular languages, you know, these are all regular. Then another, today I used to discuss Michell-Mayrhod's theorem. That is a very important theorem, and pumping lemma. There are other tools also there. There you can prove this language is regular or this language is not regular. So this is another topic you can take as your individual presentation. So this is we try to cover. Just another example, like English like sentences. Why it is, this is the example of not regular lemma with context free grammar, like sentence, noun phrase, verb. Noun phrase can be article and noun. Noun can be boy, girl, flower, teacher, anything. Article can be a, b, n. And verb like touches, likes, sees, loves, anything. So with this combination, you can have a meaningful sentence with the noun phrase and verb. So you take the noun, any one of it, article, any one of it, verb, any one of it. That is a great thing of very simple English language. It is not like our Bengali language. Bengali language rules are very tough, and the letters are too many. English language, I think, is the 26 letters is great. And in Bengali language, you see, many Bengalis cannot tell the, what are the Shorobono, Benjunbono, why different kinds of Kalibasha, Shosha, a lot of things and issues are there, but that English is great. That is the reason English is thriving. So, this is Mahill-Leroy theorem. Here we follow the Hopcroft-Ruben book. The soft copy is always with you. Sitzer's book is always with you. Yeah. What is the pumping lemma? Yeah. What is the pumping lemma? Just you believe that there should be some pumping. In regular language, there should be some pumping. Here, so if it is not pumping, then it is a finite language. If a regular language can be a finite language, say in context-free language also finite, infinite language, regular language can also infinite language, but distinction is regular language is smaller in sizes. Sizes means the variety is smaller, and context-free is more superset of regular language. So regular language, it generates infinite string. Okay. Regular language, infinite string. But the rules are there, it should be like a to the power m, b to the power n, like this. There is no relation, or a b to the power n, or maybe a cube, that is also regular. A cube is a finite language, because a, that's finished. So it is not a infinite language. Okay, so you just try to believe that, yes, that is, there should be some pumping action is going on. So what it says for any string, see w greater than m, yeah. So x, y, and this, you select a area of string, this y, it is not a single terminal, it is a substring, it should be greater than 1, greater than equal to 1, and that has to be pumped. That has been pumped, yeah, that has been pumped, that is a pumping lemma. If you say it has been pumped, that it can be a candidate for regular lemma. So this is the pumping lemma. Next comes to this. Another way of pumping lemma. So it is pumping lemma. If you have three books, three definitions you get, but more or less all same. So it is better to look every definition and then it will absorb. So my hunch is, you can make a string with like x, y, z, and y is a substring and pumping on it. Okay, and then it is a definitely regular lemma. What it says? We can use pumping lemma to prove certain language is not regular language. Okay, so if it is doesn't follow pumping lemma, that is not regular language. It is a necessary condition, but not sufficient condition. However, I will come to this. Why necessary or sufficient? However, this is a limitation. When the pumping lemma doesn't work, we can use Mahill-Leroy theorem as an universal way to prove regularity. It is two gentlemen. It is an excellent theorem. Mahill-Leroy theorem is just your regular expression, regular language must be numerable. It should be numerable classes. What is that? So, if you have a in regular language, say I have a regular expression AB, A square B square, A to the 4, A cube B cube, A 4 B 4. These are the various classes. This is regular expressions. But if I say A to the power N, B to the power N, that means n comes from 1 to infinite, then you have a infinite subclass. So you are accepting AB, you are accepting A square B square, you are accepting A cube B cube, 3 A's and 3 B's. You are accepting A to the power 4, B to the power 4, you are accepting A to the power n, any number, B to the power any number, then it is not measurable. So it is infinite. It is infinite number of classes. If you can find this kind of languages, this must not be regular. This is very obvious way, but Mahill-Leroy theorem explained it that way. We'll come to this. The pumping lemma, it is one way to detect whether the language is not regular. Whenever you see this thing, pumping lemma, then this is the, this trying and coming, like 0 to the power n, n is a perfect square. See, n is a perfect, so 0 perfect. Say you cannot make a number, not infinite. You cannot make these classes because this is infinite. N is a perfect square. This series goes on. Okay, so that is not finite. That is so that your classes is not finite. So that is the reason it is not regular as per my Hill Neroth theorem. I will come to that, this example. This is my Hill Neroth theorem. My Hill Neroth theorem says, consider a Lagrange L of strings defined over sigma input alphabet AB ending in A. It can be observed L partitions sigma such as any string ending with A, this is pass, that is you are accepting. Which ending is not A, say it is rejected. That is a two class. That can be two class. It can be observed L partitions sigma star into following two classes. C1 set of all strings ending in A. C2 set of all strings not ending in A. Since there are finite many classes generated by L, so that L is regular. So this is irregular because you have only two class. Ends with A, this is the ends with A, it is ends with not ends with A. So only two classes of, so this is irregular. But if you think of it, A to the power N, B to the power N. So it A1, A, B is a class, A square, B square is a class, A cube, B cube is a class, but A to the power N, any number is a class. So that is not possible. It says it should be finite equivalent classes. That is my Hill Neroth theorem. That is another way to see that is a regular language or not. So that is one example. Any question you can raise me anytime. Are you listening, please? Any question you can raise me at any time. Because this is an online class. This is the My Hill Neroth theorem. The My Hill Neroth theorem is another characterization of the regular languages. It uses a language to carve out the set of all strings into equivalence classes. Equivalence classes, I tell, this is a limited number of equivalence classes. Intuitively, these equivalent classes will correspond to states in minimal DFA. That is interesting. So we will use the My Hill Neroth theorem to design a DFA, because ultimately you know the DFA is the heart of all machines, even the Turing machine, even the PDA, even the finite state machine. So you should have minimum number of states, because and if you have a excess states, so that means the extra transistors. Because you need transistors, you need flip flops to make that finite state machine. And basically that goes into IC, and that if you have more transistors, more states, there will be more heating up and your power consumption will go. So you cannot send that machine to Mars. So that is the whole designing process is going on, so that our finite state machine would be the minimum number of states. And another thing is, we all know the finite state machine, whatever we discuss, actually more practical machines is Moore machine or Mealy machine. Moore machine because it gives output, because and also it can accept or not accept, so it always gives output. In our everywhere we need a finite state machine with output is good, and then this machine something is coming out. That is different output. One is accept reject at the end of the string, and another is when the stream is being tested, it is giving output. That is Mealy machine and Moore machine is giving, and I wish to tell you the Moore machine give an extra bit. Please check your earlier classes. Okay, so My Hill Neroth theorem says this minimal DFA. How? This is another way you can see it. The properties of IL in equivalence relation. We'll later see that L is regular if and only if the set of equivalent classes IL is finite. That is great. That is I wish to mention again and again. Whenever A to the power N, B to the power N, you cannot make it's an infinite number of classes. What are the infinite number of classes? A, B, A square, B square, A cube, B cube, A to the power 4, B to the power 4. So that's it. So that must not be, that is not finite equivalent classes. Application of My Hill Neroth theorem show a language is regular. Yeah, show that language is not regular, yes. Derive a finite automata for regular languages, minimum number of states. That is very, very vital, because this minimum number of states will come to this topic again and again. Okay, I think the earlier slide also same thing. Anything it extra says? My Hill Neroth theorem is, you still have useless states. I'll come to this. My Hill Neroth theorem says three states are equivalent. The language L is a subset of sigma star, because all language is coming from sigma star. Is accepted by DFA. L is the union of some of the equivalence classes. Again, it shows that of the right invariant equivalence relation to finite index. Okay. let equivalence relation RL be defined XRL Y if and only for all Z in Z star, XZ in L, XZ in YZ in L, that is finite integers. Okay. This different way it is true, but ultimately you have to remember that pumping lemma, that is pumping can be done, and if pumping can be done at two places, but there should not be any comparison. So that is the pumping lemma one for regular grammar. Will come another pumping lemma for contextual language, that is a bit tougher. That is pumping can be done at two places, but there should be coordinated. That is a context-free grammar. And what is the summary then? Summary is then my Hill error theorem. What it says? It doesn't say language L is regular if and only if it is finite. Okay. Many regular languages such as Singapore are not finite. That is interesting. That is interesting. That is the most interesting, because regular languages have to be. If finite languages are all regular, great. But that is stupid. I am telling you. Language should be infinite and regular. That is great, great. Because you need only finite state machine to acknowledge it. You don't need costly hardware like with stack. Stack means you have an extra cost of hardware design. So whatever we can do it, like yesterday I told in a compiler, in the first stage is lexical analysis. Lexical analysis is always done by a finite state machine. This finite state machine is simulated in your CPU by the compiler program. The one finite state machine detects the integer, whether it starts with 1, 2, 3 like this, whether it starts with decimal point is there. One finite state machine detects whether it's a floating point number. One finite state machine detects whether it's a variable, integer variable, or it is like this. So there are some various machines will be there. They take the strings from your C file and see it and generates tokens, and then the syntactic check will be done later. So first stage is the finite state machine for lexical analysis. So that is the finite state machine is used everywhere, not only in our machine age, in till 1980s, 90s, then all machines are finite state machine. So when the computer comes, so then the advanced programming concept comes. So that is it. So show that L partitions in sigma is infinite number of equivalent classes. So that is not regular. So if you have a that is the Mahill-Leros theorem says, if you find the equivalent classes are infinite, like a to the power n, b to the power n, or a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, that is a more powerful language, so that you cannot make a finite number of equivalent classes. So that contradicts Mahill-Leros theorem. So that must not be regular language. That's it. So this is the way you can prove it to Mahill-Leros theorem, like this one. Zero, your alphabet is 0, 1, so 0 to the power 1, it cannot be regular, because I have told same reason. Here also same thing, it is very tough. Like if a language is a W, if you repeat the string WW, say that is a context sensitive grammar. But if you say WWR, R in reverse, that is a non-deterministic period. That is also tough, but that is a less tough. So if a string W and string WR reverse, it is a palindrome. Basically, it is a palindrome. It is basically even palindrome. And if you say W hash WR, that is a odd palindrome. But W hash WR is a easy. Because if you were giving indication that hash is your midpoint, so your stack takes the popping up for matching the W. But whenever I say WW, so if you match the W with W, with stack you cannot do, because all your terminals is deep inside your stack. How can you match first character of W and first or character of second W? So that is because your beginning character terminal is at the end of the stack. You cannot access stack at the beginning. So you can ask, I can do by a queue. This thing you can try. But the thing is, that can be done easily by a Turing machine. So that is the reason it is WW is a difficult language issue. It's a context sensitive grammar. We know that I have already told that this context sensitive grammar can be done by linear bounded automata. Linear bounded automata, nothing but a Turing machine. Okay. So I'll come to this. So this is the language. This is also a formula basically. It cannot be regular. Because this 2 to the power n is can be infinite. So number of equivalent classes are huge, not only huge, is infinite. So you say that by Myhill Nerod theorem, because it doesn't get to finite number of classes, so this language can't be regular. So this is also another way you can say it cannot be done by Poulton automata also, but it can be done by a Turing machine. That we all these things you can take an example as a term paper. Like, see, what is this language? This is your task. You think of it, I'll ask you in the next class. Any question you can raise. Coming. Okay, so today's class I just end with this famous cartoon of Noam Chomsky, about Noam Chomsky, because whenever every child, we know some guys can talk from 1 year, generally around 2.5 years, any child can talk, but they are not taught grammar. So they understand grammar by the talking with the parents or near about. They understand grammar and they can generate sentences. That is the interesting part, and that is the observation by Noam Chomsky, and it has been shown all over the world. They are totally disconnected. Maybe people from Nagaland, maybe people from Andaman, maybe people from Africa, maybe people from advanced countries. The child can talk with the parents around 2 years with their mother tongue. They learned the grammar from the spoken language. That is, that then the Chomsky, Noam Chomsky told it that then language must have some rules, and that there are some innate rules so that even child can understand. Then he goes down and makes some rules like, you know, type 3 language, regular language, that is type 1, type 3, type 2, that is a context-free grammar. Type 2 is a vast amount of language. One is balanced parentheses and a to the power n, b to the power n, that is deterministic context-free grammar. It can be detected by deterministic pushdown automata. That is 99% use is unambiguous, and that is 99.9% use in our programming language, because the formal language is nothing but a programming language. Programming has some extra things, and then comes the non-deterministic context-free grammar like palindrome, odd palindrome. That is difficult in getting machine. Then comes the Turing machine. Okay, that is language type 3, type 2, that is context-free grammar, type 1, context-sensitive grammar, type 2, you know, your written communication, English sentences, and so. Okay, thank you very much for your kind hearing and all these things. Now it's open up questions. Please ask questions. Thank you.